Hello and welcome to episode 1 of Let's Play Rose Online. My name is Max the Dragon and this is my very first Let's Play. I'm a little nervous, but I'm also very excited to show you this game and to start making Let's Play videos. I'm from the Netherlands and I've been playing computer games for quite a few years. Some of them are massive multiplayer online games such as this one. I've seen a lot of people online on YouTube make Let's Play videos of all kinds of games, and they've really inspired me to create a Let's Play video of my own. And you know, if you like it and if I like it, then I might start doing this regularly. You might notice that my English is not entirely fluent. That's because it's not my first language. But I think I do a good job at giving commentary to playing this game. I'll start by telling you a few things about Rose Online. My knowledge about the game is very basic. I used to play this a couple of years back, and I decided to return because the game is still being developed a bit. There's new content, there's new updates, bug fixes, that kind of stuff. And I decided to start playing again to see this new content. And also because some of the other Let's Play videos of Rose Online on YouTube are a bit outdated now. So yeah, in this video you should see what it's like to play this game with the most recent updates. And it's also an opportunity for me to show everyone, including the developers, what it's like to start a new account. That very first in-game experience as a new player. It's something they're trying to balance out and to make more interesting, because this game does tend to be a bit of a grind for some players. But I think they do a good job at changing this, improving this. So Rose Online is an acronym. It stands for Rush on 7 Episodes. I think it used to be called 7 Hearts Episodes. It refers to a number of planets that exist in this game, and you as a player visits all of those planets and completes quests, defeats monsters, and ultimately you level up and create an account that is high level, so you can you know, start killing bosses and also engage in some PvP if you're into that. I've made an account for this Let's Play, as you can see. I'll put some links in the description that tell you where to download this game, and also how to create your own account. And as we get started with playing this game, I'll try to explain some of the bits that I know about Rose Online. So let's start by logging in. So I've made a new account for this Let's Play also because my main account has a premium service, and I want to show you what it's like to play this game and level up as a completely new character, as a new player. And the premium services has some bonuses to your experience gain, and it can possibly interfere with a brand new gaming experience. So let's create a new character. You can have 3 characters. Again, if you have the premium service, I'll explain that a bit later when we get to the item wall and stuff like that. But when you have the premium service, you can have up to 8 characters. My knowledge of this game is very basic, so I might not know everything about the game. Some things I might say that are incorrect. Feel free to correct me in the comments. Also, if you have any other suggestions, remarks, anything, let me know. I can improve my play style and obviously improve the way I make these Let's Play videos. So yeah, let's start a new character. In this game I'm also focusing on reading all of the quest dialogues, so this is a learning experience for both you as a viewer, as well as for me. I tend to skip all of those, so yeah, let's create a character. Because there are a lot of accounts in this game, because this game is so old already, it might take you a while before you have a name that isn't taken yet. I'm just gonna create a name that is identical to the account name. There's not a whole lot of customization with your character. It's nothing like Skyrim or anything like that. But you know, it's enough to create something unique for yourself. You can change your face, your gender obviously, and your hairstyle, and the hair color. That's it. And I guess that the simplicity of this has its benefits. You know, you don't have to think about it a lot. You just pick a face, pick some hair, and pick a hair color. And that way you can get into the game quickly without having to worry about every detail on your face or on your hair. This is not a new flashy graphics game. It's just a standard DirectX 9 engine, so the graphics are a bit simple, but you know, this game has other areas where it's really appealing to me. The gameplay is very interesting. It's a role-playing game, so I like it. And another big aspect of Rose Online is the fact that it's an online game, so there's a great community that still plays this game to this day. And I've noticed that they're very friendly. Most of them are very willing to help you out with any kinds of problems. There's a whole forum that you can create an account on and talk about the game. I'm not going to show that in this Let's Play, but I can explain you a few things as we go about those things. So let's pick something for our character. It's really random, I guess. Most of these are quite interesting faces. Just pick something you like. There's 29. How many is there? Oh, 29. 29 faces. Two genders, obviously. Let's see how many hairstyles there are. Oh, there we go. 21 hairstyles. And there's about 12 colors, I think. So let's pick something nice. It doesn't really matter. It doesn't affect your character in terms of stats or gameplay. It's just appearance. Okay. So I'm going to create a character that is going to be a dealer. This is one of the jobs that is available once you reach the appropriate level. Again, I'll explain this all when we get to that point, but this way you can also see some of the crafting system in this game. to make your own gear, kind of like World of Warcraft, where if you're a warrior or paladin and you pick the blacksmithing profession, you're able to create your own gear. So that should make this gameplay experience a bit more detailed, interesting. Yeah, let's go ahead with this. Alright, level 1 visitor. So, a visitor is essentially the people in this game. I think the non playable characters also refer to themselves as visitors. So, you're now one of them. But obviously, you're in control of your own visitor. You can turn your character around here, look at him. Once you start equipping some of the other gear and costumes and stuff like that, you'll see him wearing it here. But for now, he has this this starting gear. It's just very simple. And there are these butterfly wings things. It's just very basic gear, but let's log in. Once you've created a character, you start out on the Adventurer Plains. Let's double click on my... And there we go. So this is the in-game interface. You can walk around by clicking on the map, so it's a click move game. However, there's also the ability to turn your camera with the left and right key on your keyboard, and when you use the camera to point it at a certain direction, you can press forward to walk in that direction, so that's a little extra control. You start out in this ruin-like structure. This is basically the starting point for all players, all new players. And if you create new characters, they will also always start here. You can see your hit points over here. Your character name. Your mana, or MP. There's an experience bar here, and if you hover over it, you can see your current experience points and how much you have left for the next level. Your character level is displayed here, 1, and this is your character's job, and again, you start out as a visitor. There's no way to select a job until you've actually played a bit to get a certain necessary level requirement. So it's not something you select when you create a character, it's something you choose when you have done some starting quests. There's the weight indicator, so your character can take items with him. Equipment, consumable items, and materials. We'll see what that is once I kill a few monsters, and you'll see some drops. I'll pick those up, and you'll see them appearing here. And each of those items has a certain weight. So there's a total weight here. If you become overburdened, your character starts to move slowly. But in my experience, you rarely get above 100% in terms of weight. You can carry a lot of items before you actually reach this limit. This limit will go up once you level up and increase your stats. But let's first show this. This is the in-game map. It's very, very intuitive. You can see the area around you. You can see some of the NPCs. You can hover over them, dots here. You can see what their names and what kind of position they have. You can see quest start icons with the typical exclamation mark. And later, when you join a party, you can also see dots indicating where your party members are. So yeah, that's and you see obviously yourself in the middle with a with an arrow pointing in the direction where your camera is facing. You can zoom out. You can zoom in. This is just the day and night indicator. There's no kind of weather in this game apart from, you know, permanent weather in some of the areas, but it's nothing that changes. But there's a day and night cycle. You start out on the day, I think, or during the night. I think it's server based, so you could start out at night or at day, depending on when you log in. So there's the item wall. I've explained some of this when I was referring to the premium service. This is the place where you can buy items for real life money. Well, you spend real life money to buy currency in game, and with that currency you can buy these items. They're mostly items that give you temporary buffs or equipment, weapons, mounts, all kinds of refine items. It's something you don't necessarily need, but it could help you in your adventures. We've got the coordinates here. It's mostly 5,000, 5,000 something. And you can see that it changes if I move around. These coordinates are helpful to refer to certain specific places on the map. There's also the time indicator. You've got the local time and the server time. I think the server time is somewhere in the USA. I'm in Europe, so I don't really know about time zones in the USA, but I think it's USA, yeah. So yeah, there's the name of the map you're in, Adventure Plains. That's where you start out. You can remove, display, or hide the map. There's a chat window here, so you can just hit enter to type, and you can display your message. There's different chat channels for all kinds of purposes. We'll get into that later. Yeah, so let's look at the stats. This is your character's stats and properties. Zuli is the in-game currency. It's not the one that you purchase items with in the item mall. That's the currency for the item mall specifically. But the standard in-game currency where you can buy items with at NPCs is called Zuli. One of the newer things are the honor and valor and premium points. Again, that's a bit more experienced content, so we'll get to that when we're ready. Again, you have your experience bar here, HP, MP. Here it displays the number of skill points you have. You will get new skill points as you level up. You start out with nothing, and just the basic stats distribution. And once you get stat points, you can add them to a stat. It costs 3 to increase this to 16. And these stats provide certain bonuses to your character's properties, like attack, accuracy, critical, etc. And some classes have some jobs have a preference for certain stats because it increases their magical damage for a mage and that kind of stuff. We will be making a dealer, so we will start focusing on the stats that matter for a dealer. But yeah, this is it's not very complex. It looks a bit overwhelming at first, but once you get the hang of it, it makes sense, really. So you've got skills as well. These are just the basic skills that everyone has. I'll explain them a bit once we get to the skill bar here. We don't have a job yet, so this will not display anything yet. Once we pick the dealer job, we will explain what the dealer skills are about. The parts skills involves carts and castle gear. You can't ride carts until you're like level 50, so this is not something you should be concerned about when you start playing. The unique skills, again, are skills that are unique. You get them from monsters, I believe. I don't know too much about this. And there's the item mall skills. These skills are purchased in the item mall, and they give certain bonuses to stats, like attack power here. Alright, yeah, so you can learn a skill. Once I get the appropriate job, you can learn a skill by spending skill points. You get one skill point each level after level 10, so starting at level 10. So level 10, the level up to level 10 is your first skill point. And the maximum level in this game is at this point 230. So you should be getting 221 skill points. And you can distribute those across many skills. And that's sort of how you develop your character in terms of abilities. Then there's the quest tab. We will be picking up our very first quest in a minute. So it'll appear here. And you can take on 10 quests simultaneously. And 15 daily quests. You can do 15 per day, I think. This doesn't display anything yet, but we'll be using it in a bit to explain what we have to do as part of a quest. There's the community window. You can add friends. PP meet in game. You can add them here and you can see whether they're online or not. This is for chat rooms. I don't use this functionality a lot. You could send people mail, but I've never used that, actually. Let's see. Oh yeah, so there's the clan window. You can join clans in this game. You can see whether people are online, what level they are, what class they are. Job, I should say. What job they are. And you can see the clan name. Once you actually join a clan, you can see its characteristics here. You can have a little icon as your clan icon, and it'll also display your clan name and your clan icon above your username. So yeah, this is your username, and this is your hit points bar. It's useful to look at this when you're fighting monsters. So you're sort of in focus on the monster and your current hit points. There's also the system window here in the menu. You can change your settings here. Let's put this higher. If you're this game isn't very demanding because it's an older game, so if you have a recent computer, a new computer with current hardware, you can put this all at max. Here you have some options in terms of interface. You can choose to double click to attack and single click to target, or you can just single click to target and attack. Choose whatever you prefer. for chatting, you can the enter mode is where you press enter, and then you see the cursor display here, and then you can start typing. If you don't press enter and you start typing, it'll start popping up all kinds of windows, because these are hotkeys for those windows, so you have to press enter. And in normal mode, I think it always... Yeah. In normal mode, it just always displays a cursor, and whenever you type, you will always type in the chat bar. So you can't use those hotkeys. I'll put it at enter mode, that's what I'm used to. Here you have some options to block all kinds of chats in the different channels. You can block whispers in general, you block friend requests, party requests, trades, all kinds of stuff. We'll get into that once we actually start discussing that that functionality. This is the hotbar. As you can see, you can hide it and show it with this option, and there's also an alt bar. I'm going to display that. It's hidden by default, but it's pretty useful because you'll end up using all of these, and you can use the top ones for skills and food and stuff like that that you use less often. You can also lock them. By locking them, you don't actually move them or remove icons from it. That's really useful. Yeah, and if you don't know about the options, then you can just hover over them with your cursor, and you can see a little description of, about what it does. Actually, it only does that here. Yeah, so here's the menu where you get all the windows from. You can hide it with the button in the bottom right corner of the screen. So yeah, let's start playing. As you can see, it's starting to turn dark already. It doesn't actually completely turn dark, but there's a night atmosphere. You can see that the icon here has changed as well. So yeah, let's get into some quests. When you step out of this rune-like structure, you can also the camera works by clicking your right mouse button and then moving it around. It's very easy to get used to. You can click with left, and then you can move your camera with right. So yeah, this is a village in the Adventure Plains. This is Arua's Ferry. She's a visitor guide. So Arua is a god in this game, a goddess. And she represents all the good stuff in this game. And Hebarn is the evil god. And Arua battles Hebarn. And you, as a visitor, are expected to help her. And to do so, you complete quests and progress through this game. So, yeah, she says, "Welcome, Rose Let's Play. I've been expecting you. Arua summoned you here to help her in her battle against Hebarn. But first, we need to build up your strength. What should I do? Just ahead is a small village. Go speak with the village chief, Gray. I have a feeling he is in need of your help." Okay, I will. Thank you. So, yeah, that's how you start a quest. It displays a window. It does this only once to explain what quests are like. You can bring up the quest window with the button or Alt plus Q. And you can see that we now have a quest here. Speak to Village Chief Gray. Arua's Ferry has told you that Gray might need your help. Objectives: speak to Village Chief Gray. Okay. Let's do that. He's in the village here. You can see from the question mark icon that that is the person you are expected to go. If you're doing multiple quests, then you might actually see more question marks on different persons, peoples. But usually it makes sense to check the quest window to see where you need to go, which people you need to speak to. Okay, welcome Rose Let's Play. Something I can do for you. A Rose Fairy said you might need my help. You can also see the icon here. This is this displays what you need to click to like progress the quest. Some of the other options you have here are default options that they always have when you talk to them. And this icon shows you what you need to say to talk with the NPC about the quest. Arua's Fairy said you might need my help. So this actually completes the quest already. You've noticed that I get this level up effect around me. That's what you see when you level up. You can also see it on other people if they level up around you. But this quest gives enough experience to instantly level up to level 2. Ah yes, would you help us please? Just outside this village, there are a band of jellies terrorizing travelers and preventing them from passing through. If you could defeat 3 mini jelly beans, it would help with letting others through the pathway. I'm on it, Chief. Okay, so this is your standard kill a few monsters quest. We have to defeat 3 mini jelly beans and then return to Gray for our reward. So here you can see a couple of other players. One of them is in a clan, or yeah, in a clan. You can see the icon here and the clan name. I think there are a couple of more jelly beans here. Yeah, so you can see these roaming around. To attack them, just click on them. This can be a bit difficult, especially if they jump around like this. But yeah, just hover over them. You can see that your cursor turns into an attacking cursor. And then, depending on your interface setting when it comes to clicking, you either double click or you click once, and your character will start attacking it. This is just auto-attacking. Later on you'll get some skills to use in battle, but the basic fight mode is to auto-attack. We've killed one, so we get one proof of monster extermination. As you can see, we're strong enough at this point to withstand these attacks. Yeah, the monsters won't damage you a lot. Once we level up a few times and get to stronger monsters, you will see that the battles become more difficult. So yeah, you also noticed that I picked up some items. Let's kill the third mini jelly bean. So these are items dropped by the monsters. This treasure chest is Zuli, so you get a money drop from this monster. And you can see that you've picked up an item here in this window here. You can also read other status messages about having killed monsters or having made certain progress in a quest. You can also press Control on your keyboard, and it will highlight all the items that are on the floor with their names. And you can see that there's some gunpowder. Just click on it just once and it'll pick it up. So these are some of the materials. These are involved in all kinds of crafting and refining functionality. We'll get to that once we actually start needing those items for crafting. For now, we've done enough to complete this quest. We've killed 3 mini jelly beans. Very simple. So let's return to Gray. By the way, I intend to make these episodes about 45 minutes long. I've seen some people make episodes 30 minutes long. I personally like a bit longer episodes. I have a good computer and good internet, so I'm not too worried about uploading and stuff like that. But seeing as this is my first Let's Play, I'll see what it's like for me to upload these videos and see if there's any problems I need to worry about. So yeah, welcome back. Did you defeat those 3 mini jelly beans, like I asked? They weren't so tough. No, they weren't. I see. Thank you for your help. That should help keep the roads a little safer for travelers leaving the village. Anything else I can help with? So this starts a new quest. You can tell from the icon. You can exit the conversation with this option here. It was my pleasure. Have a nice day. Let's just pick this one. And you can see that, again, I get a lot of experience. Enough to level up to level 3. And I can talk to him again. And I can pick this option to start another quest. Anything else I can help you with? Actually, I could use your help once again with a small delivery. Please bring these 5 ripe bananas to the path guard, Bert. He has been helping travelers further down the road and might need this to help keep up his strength. Alright, I'll head over there now. I can also ask where is he exactly? Just follow the road leaving the village straight across the bridge. He should be in the post. He should be on post on the other side. Got it. Thank you. Okay, so sometimes you can pick different conversation dialogue options. Sometimes they exit the conversation and you don't actually take the quest. Sometimes they start the quest with some extra conversation to give some hints about the whereabouts of NPCs and or how to get items or where to find monsters. As a reward, I got some experience, as you could see, from the level up as well. But there's also a food reward. I had 5 apples already, I think. Or they were different. Oh yeah, they were the reward of the first quest we completed. And then we got another 10. We can put these on the alt bar, and you can click on the, you can double click on them and it'll start healing you. You can even consume food during battle, especially during battle. And it's not an instant heal, it heals over time. So it's 85. Yeah, so it restores HP over time. Yeah, so if you click it with your right mouse key, then it'll display a hint about the item, a description. But if you let go of it while you have the cursor on the item, it'll actually use it. That's a bit awkward, but yeah, so I ate an apple. If you're full health, the health over time effect will stop immediately. So it won't heal you over your max HP, but if you get damaged again after being full health, you will have lost some of the food effectivity because the healing over time has stopped because you got full health. So try to use the food only when you're damaged but reasonably a lot. So that you get the full effect from the food item. There's also the special package. Once you're at level 10, you can open this and it gives you some boost items. They boost certain stats so you can kill monsters more quickly. Also, we have the Peacock Feather now. I think that was a reward from a quest. Let's equip that. So that's how you equip an item. You can drag it to the appropriate slot. And this is just the basic gear that we start out with. You can see the restriction. Some of the items are restricted to your own account. This is called a character, so if you have multiple characters, you can still, even if this is account locked, you can still trade this between accounts. But you can't trade this with other players. There's also the character lock, which means that it's actually locked to the character. You can see some of the stats on the equipment. Defense 5, magic defense 7, dodge rate 0. So there's the durability as well. All items have durability. I think the max durability is 100. Once your item becomes damaged, it will go down to 0 eventually. And if it's 0, then the item becomes unusable. It'll turn red, and you'll see an indicator here as well, below your character overview. And you will... It won't break, but you will temporarily lose whatever stats there are on the item, even though you still have it equipped. And in order to get those stats back, you have to repair the item. You can do so at certain NPCs. I think there's one here. Yeah, Smith. Actually, let's take his quest as well. Yep. So, something I find a bit confusing is that the icons that I showed you when talking to Gray, they don't always appear. It's a bit random. But you can pick the different conversation options to see if it actually triggers starting the quest. But this is primarily a vendor. You can buy some weapons here. I wouldn't buy these weapons at this point because you'll get some nice gear to start with once you complete some of the other quests further down the road. But you know, you can look at them and you can see what kind of requirements there are. Yeah. So this is a repair hammer. You shouldn't use this because this actually, although you can use it as an item anywhere, it reduces durability, I think. The max durability on your item will go down. The best way to repair your equipment is to just have this selected in NPCs like Ronk. You can select the option to repair an item and then you just get a hammer icon and you can click on your equipment to repair them. They're not damaged now. You can see from the durability if they're damaged, but you can also see that there is a certain cost for repairing them, which also means that they're damaged. The more damaged they are, the more it costs to repair them. And just to exit this, just click somewhere outside the window. Yeah, just this exits the conversation. So yeah, this is to buy weapons. This is to exit the conversation. This is to repair an item. Then this must be the option that triggers the quest. So welcome, Rose Let's Play. My name's Ronk, and I'm the smith here on Adventure Plains. Is it true that I can wear a different visitor look? Sure, I don't know where you visitors get that idea from. Maybe it's born into you. But yes, the Mother Koropis, actually like chewing on old clothes and shoes, like visitor sandals and visitor looks. Go hunt the Mother Koropi, and you're sure to find a look that suits you. This is just a very tiny quest to get two visitor equipment items that are just for appearances. But, you know, we will complete all of the content in the game, at least that's what I'm aiming for, so let's also do these quests. There's also a bunch of repeatable quests later on. I will try to do them at least once. Let's move on to Bert. We had to deliver some bananas to him. You can tell where he is on the map from the hints from the NPCs, of course, but he's also here in the mini-map. Just cross the bridge. Whoops. Click on the NPC to select him and then click again to start talking to him. Nobody passes through these parts without me knowing it, you can be sure. Gray told me to give this to you. You must be Rose Let's Play. I heard you helped defeat some jelly beans. Do you think you could help me out too? Sure, what do you need? Ah, I leveled up again. Early on you get so much exp from all of the quests that you level up instantly. Personally, I think that's a bit... you level a bit too fast for my personal preference, but it's good to see that quests early on reward you by gaining strength quickly because you level up. Koropis have been attacking travelers for their food, and we need to put up a shop. We need to put a stop to it. Please go and defeat 5 Koropis and 1 Mother Koropi to help drive them back from the roads. Okay, got it. Okay, so again we need to kill some monsters. Usually in this area the monsters you need to kill are very close to the NPC that starts the quest. You can see one here. If you need to know what a monster is called, just hover over them and you can see their name. I think I can also explain a bit about the monster's strength compared to your own strength, because this is displayed in the color of the name. You can see that this is a fake yellow-brown color. These are monsters that are about your level or just very slightly over your level. This is usually the kind of monster that you want to fight, because they give 100% of the experience and 100% of the item drop rewards. Once you start leveling up, you can still come back and kill these monsters, but obviously they'll be weaker. They'll be equally strong, but you'll be much stronger than them. And you will see this by their name changing color. It starts from purple, which is very strong, and it's like 20 levels above you. Then it turns from purple, it turns to pink, and then to a red color. And then it turns brown like this. And then from brown it turns into green, which is like just slightly below your level. And also when it starts to turn green, you'll know that the monster starts giving less experience points, about 80%. And then when it's blue, light blue, or cyan, it gives even less experience points, about 50%. And then when it's totally weak compared to you, it'll be white or gray, and then you barely get any experience points from it anymore. So it's shield seed just a waste to fight these monsters unless you're looking for specific items from them. Let's kill them. Mini Kurobis. So yeah, these quests both require you to kill Mother Kurobi. And once we encounter a Mother Kurobi, you'll see that killing it once will actually give you the requirement for both of these quests. Now this is a pretty self-explanatory. You see the damage above their heads and damage above your head. There are also heal spells that people or yourself can cast, and they're displayed with a green number. When you eat food, it doesn't actually display numbers, it just gradually recovers your health. It does display an effect with red plus symbols to indicate that you're slowly healing, slowly recovering. Yeah, let's kill another Kurobi, mini Kurobi. So yeah, you can see that despite not actually eating any food, you always have some kind of HP recovery. Because we're not being damaged a lot, you can see that we heal up to full health pretty quickly. But later on you'll start to see that the base HP recovery isn't actually enough to keep you healed. You can heal up without using food outside of battle by sitting. This is an icon that is in your hotbar by default. Sitting recovers HP more quickly, it's about 5% per second, and this is something you can do in between battles if monsters damage you by a lot. And you don't want to use food, you can just sit, but obviously it takes a while to recover your health, so it makes quests and monster killing take a bit more time. Let's organize some of these basic skills. So let's go to game options to unlock these bars again, so you can change the icons. If there's no icon on it, you can just drag them onto the bar, but if there's something already there, then you need to unlock the bars to be able to replace or move around icons. Normal attack, that's not really useful. You'll always do a normal attack, that's part of the auto-attacking. The dual scratch is a useful skill at this point. But I want pick up as my F1 key. So pick up, or using the F1 key in this case, it'll allow you to pick up a nearby item. So if we just stand up, just click somewhere near you and it'll stand up. And then just attack a monster. So yeah, you can either just click on the item like we used to do, but you can also just use the pickup skill. In this case, just press F1. And your character will walk towards the closest item and it will pick it up automatically. And this is useful if there's lots of items lying around and you just want to quickly pick them up. You can just mash F1. So we've got 4 Caropis now. So that's the mother Caropi. He looks the same, but he's... She, I should say. she's a little bigger. I know that this one is a little stronger, but we should be able to kill it without using food. Or not. Yeah, so it's when fighting the Mother Caropi, it's good to keep keep your HP bar in focus. Yeah, let's eat some food. Double click on the item, and you can see that we're recovering health. Using one apple will do, actually. So this monster has this shield icon. There are different types of monsters in terms of battle characteristics. The shield icon refers to monsters that have more defense, so they take longer to kill, or you have to be, have higher attack skills to kill it more quickly. The icon here is just the standard monster icon. So these are just default default stats on this monster. It should be less challenging to beat the mini Caropis. Okay, so let's pick up the pink powder. Sometimes you'll notice that there are items that are stuck inside of trees or rocks that you can't access. I think, yeah. You can try picking them up with the F1 key, but if that doesn't work, just walk away, because you can't actually take them. Sometimes they're inside trees, and, you know, it's just you're not able to pick them up. So, we killed the Mother Caropi just yet. And this instantly completed the other quest we were doing with the visitor gear. As you can see, this is just gear with the same stats as what you were already wearing. Yeah, it's just for appearances. I like this. Let's go back to the NPC, to Bert, to turn in the quest. Nobody passes through these parts without me knowing it, you can be sure. I've defeated the Caropis and Mother Caropi. Excellent work. That should help drive them back for now. Thank you. Don't mention it. And again, we get a lot of experience from the quest. And we level up instantly. While you're here, would you mind doing one last favor for me? There's a boy, Huey, across the bridge who could use your help. Please go speak with him. Okay, thanks. So now we have this. This is a spear weapon. It's actually better than the wooden sword, so let's go equip it. And as you can see, we're now level 5. We're about 12%, 13% away, on our way to level 6. And we've gathered some materials from the monsters already. Yeah, you can see that the quest gave 314 experience points. And we also have the Ripe Banana, which is a booster. If you use this item, you get a temporary buff to your speed, in this case. Your speed will be boosted by 50% for 3 minutes. And then it also refers you to another speed booster that is available from the item mall. Again, you need to pay money to get currency to buy those items, so you can't get them unless you're willing to pay money to buy those items. Real life money. And you also get the Kuropi, and it's a mount, it's a very basic mount. It has a movement speed of 1500, which is a lot faster than just walking. But it's limited to 15 days. And I think that is real time. So if you log out, I think it'll still continue counting down, but we'll check that next time we log in. Put it on your hotbar so you can use it quickly. You can't use it in battle, obviously, but what you can do if you're able to escape from a monster by running away, just clicking in the opposite direction basically, and you get outside its range. You can sometimes just click on it and it'll mount up, and you can just escape more easily. You can dismount by clicking it again, and as you can see, you can move around a lot faster. This is really useful to get to NPC locations quickly when doing quests early on. But obviously, since it's a limited use item, eventually you'll have to find different types of mounts or the cart skill, which is available at level 50. So let's talk with Huey, boy by the cart. "I'm a good boy, yes I am. My dad told me to stay near the cart, and that's exactly what I'm going to do." "Huey, Bert told me you need help." "He did? I was sent here to collect seeds from the Flanays, but I can't leave the cart because my dad is worried that monsters will steal from us. Could you help me by collecting Flanay and Elder Flanay seeds? The Flanays are just up the hill, where there is a small farmland." "I would do it, but like I said, I can't leave the cart." "Sure, I'll be right back." So Flanays are flower type monsters. Huey directs us to this farming patch here. Just go up the hill and you can see them. Later on you'll encounter stronger types of Flanay that can be aggressive. They're also ranged attacking monsters. I'll just show that right now. See, if I walk away, this is how you escape from battle, but as you can see, this is a ranged attacker. It'll continue to attack me until I move out of range far enough for it to stop attacking. But we will just kill it instead. We will bring up the quest window to see how we're doing. So we kill 5 of these, and 1 Elder Flanay. The Elder Flanay is actually over there. Pick up the ink item. Some of the monsters respawn very quickly, so even if there's a lot of players doing this quest here, there's also a hill where you can fight monsters. Most of them respawn quickly. Later on you will encounter stronger monsters in quests that might not respawn quickly, and you'll just have to wait. So we got 2 seeds. As you can see, these monsters aren't too strong. The only reasonably strong monster we've fought so far is the Mother Kuropi. So I've leveled up again. As you can see, you level up pretty quickly at this point in the game. And there's also an HP point. This is just an item. If you pick it up or just walk over it, you'll get some HP back. There's also the blue MP points, which does exactly the same thing, but then for your MP bar. Okay, let's move on to the Elderfane. As you can see, this is a bow icon. It shows that the monster is a ranged type monster, but there are different ranger type monsters that don't have this icon, so it doesn't always... not every monster who is ranged, a ranged attacker has the bow icon. But the bow icon does make the monster of a range type, which just affects what items it can drop in terms of equipment. So we got the Elder Fennae Seed, and we got 5 normal Fennae Seeds. Actually, by killing that Fennae, that Elder Fennae, you get both an Elder Fennae Seed and 1 normal Fennae Seed. So you only have to kill 4. Flanays, actually, despite the quest description saying 5 Flanays, but that's good. I'm a good boy, yes I am. Well, I've collected the seeds you asked for. You did? Wow, you're quick. While I have you here, my dad could sure use your help. Will you help us? Sure. What do you need me to do? Can you please fill 5 containers of honey from the young honeybees? You can find the bees just west of here and on your left. When you're done collecting the honey, could you please bring it back to me? Please bring it to my dad. He's a farmer named Claude, and our farm is just down the road to the west. He'll be waiting for you. Thanks, Rose Let's Play. Sure, no problem. Alright. Let's kill the monsters. Just move where he tells you to move. And you'll find these bees. Young honeybee. Even though the draw distance setting does increase the draw distance for the static environment, so like the rocks and the mountains and the grass, you won't actually see monsters appear until you move a bit closer, so it might actually seem as if this area is pretty empty, but if we move towards it... sometimes it'll fill up with monsters. And then you can attack more of them. But I guess there are not more monsters here. Alright. So let's use the F1 key here. I'm gonna add some more skills to the hotbar now. Let's put the sit skill on F2, then the trade on F3, party on F4, and vending on F5. And let's put this on F6. It's a dual scratch skill. I'll use this in one of the battles coming up next, like this one. Just use the skill by double clicking on it. And you'll see your character do some special move. There are skills that deal more damage or damage over time. Or there are area of effect skills that deal damage to a group of monsters standing around you. Or at a certain spot. But once we learn more skills from our job, I'll tell you about what they do. So the trade skill is used for trading with other players. You just select another player by clicking on them once, and then you double-click the trade skill, and it'll send a request to initiate a trade. And if the other player accepts it, you'll be able to trade items. The party skill works similarly, but they will get a request to create a party with you. Parties are a way to group up with other players, preferably from your level range. So if they're a lot weaker or a lot stronger than you shouldn't really party up with them. When you're in a party, you can do quests, and whenever a party member like does something to progress the quest, like kill a monster or obtain a certain item, then it will count for all of the party members. So if I was in a party with 5 people and each of them killed one of these bees, we would all get 5 of these honey items. So that's a way to quickly do a quest. You also get shared experience and drops. The monsters still drop only one item, but you can either take the items yourself, or you can set it up so that it distributes the item to a random player in the party. And the experience is just shared among all the party members. There's also the party level. As you kill more monsters that are within your level range, you get a higher party level percentage. And then when it's 100%, it'll level you up. But you have to continue killing monsters because the percentage drops over time. But once you actually get a party level, that party level will stay. And with higher party levels, you get more experience shared among the party members. So yeah, I don't think I'll be doing parties a lot. Sometimes maybe it's useful to do so, but in this Let's Play I'm just gonna show you what it's like to play solo mostly. There's also the thing that people get buffed by clerics. A cleric is a secondary job in this game where you can heal and buff other players in a party or just anywhere. These buffs are pretty powerful. If a high level cleric gives me all of his buffs, then I'm more than twice as strong. I'll get more than twice the health and the strength and the attack power and defenses and so on. So that's something I'm gonna try to avoid doing because it affects how fast you can kill monsters and thus how fast the gameplay progresses. By a lot, it makes a serious difference. I'm not gonna do that. I can't prevent people buffing me because I don't have to accept their buff or anything. So if it happens, well, that's fine. But I'm not gonna ask for buffs. So yeah, we've actually completed this. So yeah, just stand somewhere, mount up, and then just ride back to... oh no, wait. We were supposed to go to the pumpkin patch. Sometimes it's a bit confusing. You have to read the quest descriptions carefully, because sometimes it appears as if you're supposed to go back to the quest giver, but then they actually tell you to turn in the quest at somebody else. So that's something to read carefully. Sings. Work, work, work all day long. Work, work, work while I sing this song. You always got to be entertaining yourself while farming. It's a rule. Huey said that you needed this honey. That's my boy, and you know what? He's right. I did need it. While you're here, I sure could use some help. Sure thing. And again, I turn in the quest, so I level up. This is not going to be something that will happen every time you complete a quest, because the experience you need per level is going to ramp up pretty quickly, so you'll start to have to kill a lot of monsters and complete a lot of quests to gain a level. But for now, it's just a quick level up experience. You see, these here pumpkins have become difficult to manage. I reckon you need... I reckon. There's some spelling errors in some of the messages, but... I reckon I need your help. I need you to help collect your seeds. Collect 5 pumpkin seeds and 1 big pumpkin seed. Think you can do that for a tired old farmer? No problem, I'm on it. So as you can see, we're level 8 and we're pretty far on our way to level 9. So let's quickly complete this quest. Just stand here and dismount. You can't actually fight while you're mounted, and if you're getting attacked by a monster, then you should dismount quickly, because otherwise you can't defend, you can't attack back. There's also the cowboy pumpkin here. He's a bit stronger. I'm not gonna buff myself, but if you're getting buffs from players here, you might want to try fighting this, because it gives a lot of experience. Scroll down, actually. 187. Let's see. Big pumpkin. Again, this is a shield type monster, so you can tell that it's... that has a high defense. Just watch your health, health when you're fighting this. Yeah, let's use an apple. When you use the apple, you can see an icon here. It displays the health over time you're getting. And you can tell that it's just a few seconds. When the icon disappears, if you eat another apple, you will get the maximum effect from the healing item. Because if you're eating another apple while you're being healed, I think it overrides the old heal over time. Yeah. Just 3 more pumpkins. Glue and Junonian salt water. This item is actually part of an event. You won't get this you might not get this. Oh, not that one. Let's see, pumpkin. Go. Level 9. One more. And as you can see, by completing these quests, you get to level 10 pretty easily. And after this guy, we're gonna go to this little camp where you can pick a job. Once you've met the level requirement of 10. But yeah, let's turn in this quest. Work, 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 blah, blah, blah. I've brought back the seeds. You did. That was fast. Now I see why Huey speaks so highly of you. I reckon you're going to fit in just here. Fine, here just fine. Thanks. Say, you've been such a great help. And surely on your way to becoming a great help to Arua. Just to the north of here is a village full of trainers, who I'm sure would love to help you train and get stronger. You're strong enough now, and the trainers can't help increase your abilities. To get there, just head up this road, this here road to the north, towards the valley of Luxem Tower, and you'll see the small training center on your left. Good luck. Wow, sounds cool, thanks. So, he says you're strong enough, but actually you're not strong enough, because we're still level 9. Just kill a few monsters here. Just, kill the pumpkins. The big pumpkins are shield-type monsters, as I showed you before, so it's a bit less efficient to kill them. Because it takes longer to kill them, and they don't give a lot more experience, I think. I don't know, let's try, actually. Eat some food. Because we're slowly dying. So, the quests you've completed up to now, they give you these booster items. They give small bonuses to your stats, but I tend to not use them until a bit later. Once the level up becomes more challenging, I use these to give myself a quick boost, which helps killing monsters faster. And thus, level up faster. Yeah, so the big pumpkin gives about 60 more experience than the small pumpkin, but it takes considerably longer to kill it. So just focus on the small pumpkins. Sometimes it's a bit difficult to click on them because they jump away or they move around. When you level up, you get an instant full heal, so We don't have to use an item, or we can just pick up these. That works too. One more, I think. There we go. Level 10. Now that we are level 10, we can actually open that special package here. Just double click on it, and you get some more interesting boosters. I'll just put them here. And the package contains another package that you can open at level 18, and it'll continue to contain some packages that you can open at later levels. I think it goes up to level 50. So yeah, just leave this area. We're done here. And move to the training camp that Claude mentioned. Now, this is where it gets interesting. So you've got four NPCs here. We've got Media, the Muse Trainer. We've got Murphy, the Soldier Trainer in the back. Titania, Dealer Trainer, and Connor Harker Trainer. So these four represent the first jobs you can choose. Now, a job is like classes from different games. It's like something you choose that defines your gameplay style. It determines how you fight in battles. It determines your skills. It determines what other abilities outside of battles you have, like crafting or buffing, healing, that sort of stuff. And yeah, just pick something you like. I'm gonna go over them. So the Muse is like the magical type of job in this game. From the first jobs, you can, once you are level 100, you can choose a secondary job, and whatever job you pick now as your first job determines what secondary job you will be able to choose. The Muse is the magical type, and it'll at level 100 it'll go into the Mage and the Cleric. The Mage is the more offensive magical type, so it has all the kinds of spells to attack monsters, fireballs, all that kind of shit. And the Cleric is a class that has supportive abilities and defensive abilities that help you get healed or get buffed with stat bonuses, like these items, but then they have it in skills. So yeah, if you're into magic, you should choose the Muse. The Soldier is the warrior knight melee type class. He wears armor. He wields swords, spears, axes, that kind of stuff. I used to play this game, and I picked the Soldier, and later on I picked the Knight. The other secondary job you can be after Soldier is the Champion. I think the Champion is more offensive class. It has more specialities in terms of weapons and weapon skills. And the Knight is a more defensive class. I think it doesn't follow this rule strictly, because if you choose a certain stat distribution or certain equipment, you can still make a very offensive Knight or a very defensive Champion. But that's just the general idea of those jobs. Yep, so if you're into melee close hand battle, then you should pick the soldier. The dealer is a class that involves dealing with items. It's the class that has the crafting abilities. It has all kinds of abilities to create items. And the dealer is also the class, the job that wields ranged weapons such as guns and cannons, firearms basically. The dealer can, at level 100, can turn into the bourgeois or the artisan, and the artisan is a more it's a job more focused at creating items. All of these jobs can still be used in battle and have their own unique properties, but the general idea is that the artisan is an item crafter, and the bourgeois is more focused at weapons, so combat with guns and cannons. So if you're into some heavy ranged combat with bombs and guns and cannons, and then you should pick the dealer. And lastly, there's the hawker. It's the more agile type of class. It wields claws and weapons like that. It's a class that at level 100 can turn into either a scout, which is a ranged type class that deals with bows, or it can turn into the raider, which is a class that deals with claws and close hand combat. Yeah, so if you're into that, pick the hawker. I'm gonna pick the dealer, because I want to show you some of the item crafting stuff. Greetings, Rose Let's Play. My name is Dealer Trainer Titania, and I'm in charge of helping visitors become the greatest dealers ever known. Is there something I can do for you? Claude sent me. He said you can help me, could help me. You can choose some of the other dialogue options to learn a bit more about dealers. Actually, I might just do that. You can also trade with them, but that's still available after doing this job selection quest. So the dealer is all about range and skill. Being an ace gunman, don't forget to buy ammo from me, or a skilled craftsman. They use ranged weapons to fight from afar with skills and tools to augment their abilities to change the flow of combat. Does this sound something like you want to be? If you're not sure, I'd suggest speaking with the other three trainers, just to be sure. I'm just gonna quickly talk to the other trainers just to show you the description they give of the class. It's probably more reliable than what I told you. So can you tell me more about the Muse class? Being a Muse is about using magic. They are able to use both offensive and supportive magics, but are weak against physical attacks. Does this sound like something you want to be? If you're not sure, I suggest speaking with the other three trainers, just to be sure. Can you tell me more about the soldier class job? The soldier is all about physical strength. They are great at close combat with hard-hitting skills and high physical defense. Does this sound something like you want to be? If you're not sure, talk to your dudes. And gal. Two gals, actually. Hawker. Can you tell me more about the hawker class? The hawker is all about speed and agility. They can be good at close combat when using katars or dual swords. Yeah, that's the one I forgot about. They can dual wield swords. Or from a distance when using a bow. That's what the scout is about. They may not hit as hard, but they make up for that with their speed of blows. Does this sound like something you want to be? If you're not sure, talk to the other three people. So yeah, let's pick the dealer class. Yes, that's me. I want to be a dealer. You need to be absolutely sure. Once you become a dealer, there's no going back. Are you sure you want to be a dealer? Yeah, so pick carefully, because you can't change it. Okay, so now we're a dealer. We didn't have to do anything to become a dealer. So that's easy. I think I'm going to end the episode here. So yeah, in this episode we landed on the Adventurer Plains. We did some quests, we did a lot of explanation on the basic stuff in-game. Also, let me show you this this job section now that we're actually a dealer. You can see the offensive, the common offensive and crafting skill trees. And as you can see, we've got one skill point. And we can buy or learn a class, learn a skill. And you can also level up those skills up to a maximum of 5. Passive skills like these, they act permanently, not as something you would have to use. They cost 2 skill points per level up or to learn it. So, and you know, it depends on your playstyle what you pick. Some of the skills are mandatory for just about any kind of build, but some of the skills you won't probably end up getting because they're not as useful. There's some guides online if you're into you know, perfecting your build. You can get a lot of advice from players in-game as well as in the community, and those websites offer a lot of information about what skills to pick to make a good build. I might look into that a bit more to decide what to pick for this character, but I'm sure I'm gonna pick some of the crafting skills. Yep. So yeah, that's it for this episode. I don't know how long I've been recording so far. I haven't checked the time so far. It might be actually a long episode, but I guess that's part of the learning experience for me as a Let's Play creator. Yeah, if you have any suggestions, comments, just put them in the comments below. I really appreciate you know, constructive criticism. So if you feel like you need to tell me I should do things differently, or just go ahead and tell me. I don't mind. And yeah, if you like the video, like it. Dislike it if you dislike it. And I'll see you with the next episode. Thank you for watching. Goodbye.